We hope you enjoy the following video presentation sponsored by the C.S. Lewis Foundation. We are a nonprofit organization with a mission to equip and encourage Christians to live their faith within the world of ideas and arts. To help us continue to host events and make videos like this one, please make a donation after viewing the video by going to www.cslewis.org or clicking the link below. Thank you.
But I'll never forget when I came here again 9 years ago. I had a little bit more hair, and it was not quite so gray back then. And it was a wonderful experience. I got on the plane at Bush Airport in Houston, Texas, where I'm from, and it is a direct flight to Heathrow. And it was a great flight. And when I got to Heathrow Airport, the first thing I needed to do was find a public restroom, as you would imagine. Now, there I was, minding my own business, when the guy in the next stall, now, I'm not going to try to imitate his British accent, but the guy says to me, "How you doing, mate?" And I thought, no, I'm much too tired for this. This is not how I want to begin my Oxbridge experience. But I'm a Christian guy, and so I said, I'm doing okay. Now, I was really hoping this was the end of the conversation. But a few seconds later, the guy says, "And how you feeling this day?" And I thought the British were reserved. This was a nightmare, something out of the Twilight Zone. But when in Rome, do as the Romans do. And so I kind of said, I'm kind of tired, but I'm okay, I guess. Now, I was really, really hoping this was the end of the conversation. But a few seconds later, the man says, "Hey, mate, want to meet me for a pint at the pub?" This was too much intimacy for this situation. I said, "Sir, I'm sorry, I'm tired, I have a busy day, I can't go." A few seconds later, the man said, "Hey, John, I got to call you back in a few minutes. There's some idiot here who keeps talking to me." So beware of international travel. It can be very, very dangerous. Beware. So I'm going to speak to you today about virtue in the Chronicles of Narnia. And I want to begin by making a statement. It is often said that virtue is no longer taught in American public schools. That is not exactly the case. I almost wish it were the case. What happens in American public schools is not that we've thrown out virtue. What we have done in our public schools is substitute them with counterfeit virtues. Because we, you know, Aristotle said we are by nature political animals. Well, we're also moral, ethical animals. We cannot exist without morality, ethics, and virtue. And nature, as Aristotle said, abhors a vacuum. So what has happened in the public schools and the academia is, rather than throw out virtue altogether, give us a substitute. Virtue is taught. These are the four virtues that are taught in our public schools and university: tolerance, multiculturalism, egalitarianism, and environmentalism. Now, I'm not saying that those things are evil. They can be very good. But they are not and have never been at the center of what the virtues are. We give them these things so that they think they don't have to worry about the real virtues. I wish I was making this up. But in our modern schools, a young man may be sleeping around, but he thinks it's okay because he recycles his cans. Now, I wish that was an exaggeration, but it is not. We have substitute virtues. What I want to do this morning is get back to the real virtues. And throughout the Middle Ages and right up throughout the church history, there has been an understanding that there are seven basic virtues. There are the four classical or cardinal. There are the four classical or cardinal virtues, and there are the three theological or Christian virtues. And in Mere Christianity, C.S. Lewis discusses all seven of those virtues. Now, what is the difference between a classical virtue and a Christian or
Keep going.
Oh. Wait, what's wrong? Oh, okay. We're moving me away here. Okay. There we go. I'm being experimented on.
It's no risk. He'll keep going.
That's true. The age of the machine. Oh, that's better. Okay, good. You still hear me? Up there? Okay, good. The difference between the two is that the classical virtues are virtues that were understood and to a certain extent practiced by the higher pagan people, the higher Greeks and Romans, Plato, Aristotle, Virgil, Cicero, the people that Dante considered virtuous pagans. Now, how is it that they had access to these virtues? They had access through what theologians call general revelation. Theologians make a distinction, and this is not just Catholic, this is Calvinist, Reformed theologians as well, it's in the institutes, make a distinction between general revelation and special revelation. General revelation is what we all have access to because we were made in God's image and God implanted in us a supernatural conscience. We also can study nature, we can study the world, and through that study, we can perceive or apprehend these virtues. We cannot practice them perfectly, we are unregenerate, but we can make a movement towards an understanding. These four classical or cardinal virtues are courage, or in Latin, fortitude. Then there is self-control, or in Latin, that would be temperance. Then there is wisdom, or in Latin, prudence. And then there is justice, which is already a Latin word, so we're okay there. So those are the four classical virtues. Those four virtues are described in detail in Plato's Republic, and they are also described in detail in Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics. And they appear, of course, in Cicero and other writings as well. Now, we need to distinguish those four virtues from the three Christian or theological virtues that only come to us via special revelation. Special revelation comes to us through the Bible, through the prophets, and most supremely, through Christ himself. Not all people have access to special revelation. Now, that doesn't mean nobody ever heard the word faith, hope, and love in the pre-Christian days, but the full understanding of what those virtues meant awaited the New Testament and Christ. And you'll recognize 1 Corinthians 13, these three things remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of them is love. Now, in the King James, it will say faith, hope, and charity. What is the difference between faith, hope, and charity and faith, hope, and love? There really isn't a difference. The word charity comes directly out of the Latin caritas. The word caritas is a Latin version of the Greek word agape. And interestingly, although people today tend to know a little more Latin than Greek, everybody knows the word agape. Don't you all recognize that word? Mostly because of a book called The Four Loves, which passes down to us in innumerable sermons, although the sermons somehow lose the fourth one, storge or affection, and you all know the three. There is eros, erotic love, philia, friendship love, and agape, God's self-giving love. So agape becomes caritas, caritas becomes charity. So the King James is right to use that word. Unfortunately, in our day and age, the word charity has lost a great deal of its meaning. Rather than connoting the fullness of agape, it has been reduced to mean giving charity to the poor. Now, that is obviously part of caritas, but it does not exhaust the meaning of that word. So I prefer to use faith, hope, and love so we don't misunderstand. But again, when I say love, think of the word agape. What I want to do this morning is take you through the seven virtues, illustrating them with episodes from the Chronicles of Narnia. Now, I'll tell you up front, I'm not going to do the planet Narnia thing. Now, I do believe Michael Ward has got something there of the seven planets, but I don't want you to think that the seven virtues equal the seven Chronicles of Narnia. Lewis did not do that. In fact, almost every chronicle is going to embody more than one of the virtues, but I'll just be choosing a few select episodes because I want us not only to understand intellectually what these virtues mean, I want us to see these virtues embodied, incarnated in the wonderful Chronicles of Narnia. Let us begin with courage. There's no official ranking of the classical or cardinal virtues, but I begin with courage for the same reason that Lewis often began with courage. Courage, he said, is virtue at the breaking point. If you don't have courage, you cannot practice any of the other virtues. Remember what Screwtape said? Pilate was merciful until it got risky, and he lacked the courage, and he pandered to the crowd and turned Jesus over. So we cannot practice any virtue if we don't have courage. Now, courage, as Eric already mentioned, courage, it's the French word for the heart, something coming out of the heart. And I think the best definition of courage, not from Aristotle, but farther back from Plato, is courage as something that has staying power. Plato compares courage to a sort of, we call it a color-fast dye, a dye that stays and doesn't get washed out every time you wash it out. Courage stays. It sticks to its post. You know, we have this idea, because we know about the Romans, that all the Romans believed suicide was the greatest thing. Well, that's true and it's not true. Cicero, who was their greatest moralist, was not a fan of suicide. Now, he wasn't against suicide for the Christian reason. He was against suicide because to kill yourself is to abandon your post. It is actually an act of cowardice. Courage is also that which endures. Have you noticed that in the Chronicles of Narnia, and even more in the Lord of the Rings, what do they do a lot of? Walking. Walking, and you're going to be doing a lot of walking in the next few days. Walking, walking, walking. But it's important. Remember, both Lewis and Tolkien served in World War I, where you march, 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 march. And courage means continuing, enduring. You don't give up the fight. You continue on. Courage does not mean rushing in like a madman shooting your gun. That's not courage. That's foolhardiness. Courage has to have the proper motivation. It has to have wisdom tied to it. It needs to understand what it's doing. Courage means being the bridge over which others can cross. Courage often is a kind of self-emptying. Some of you know the word kenosis, when it says that Jesus emptied himself. The Greek word is kenosis. Courage empties itself and is willing to be the bridge over which others can cross. Now, the greatest act of courage in all seven of the Chronicles of Narnia does not come in any of the battle scenes. And there are actual battle scenes in Narnia. It's not just in the movie. They just last longer in the movie. There are battle scenes, but and courage is important there. But the supreme act of courage is in The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, when Aslan, from a position of strength, willingly lays down his life on the stone table. And folks, sometimes when we think of the crucifixion of Christ, all we ever focus on is the physical pain. In fact, if you're a Baptist like me, or probably if you're Reformed as well, you've probably been to more sermons than you want where some engineer who's about 6'5" will tell you in excruciating detail exactly what it's like to die of crucifixion. Unbelievable. I was in a panel with one of these engineering guys, and we were discussing the Passion of the Christ, and I'll never forget, the man said, "The movie was not accurate. I counted, and they gave Jesus 43 lashes." Now, what kind of left-brain mind could sit there coldly counting during that scene? I do not know. But anyway, the pain was tremendous, okay? But the pain lasted for about 3 hours. I would argue that the greater sacrifice, the greater pain, the greater thing that Christ endured, as Aslan does in The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, is the betrayal and the humiliation. My kids, they're in Stratford right now, but you'll meet them later. They said, "We've heard you speak. We're going to Stratford." But anyway, they'll be back. But have any of you ever seen the cartoon version of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe? It's actually quite good. Very, very low budget. But it's actually quite good. And I remember showing it to my kids when they were very young. And when we watched the crucifixion scene of Aslan, my daughter Stacy, she was about 5 at the time, do you know what part upset her the most? It was not the killing. It wasn't the beating. Do you know what upset her the most? She kept saying over and over, "I can't believe they cut his hair. I can't believe they shaved his mane." She understood that the humiliation was in some ways even worse than the pain. It took courage to endure that. And there's a wonderful line in there. Remember, the two girls, Lucy and Susan, are watching this from a hiding place. And it says that after they shaved his head and they were beating on him, Lucy looked at him and suddenly he looked braver and stronger than he had ever looked before. there in a moment. Again, he looks like a big cat, as the evil characters say. And yet, the courage he has to endure, to continue on. That's what courage is, right? It's shown in endurance, and it is shown in sticking to your post, no matter the cost. Eric, my friend Eric, by the way, you are hearing from two Greek Yankees in a matter of 3 hours. This is pretty amazing, okay? So this is exciting stuff. Again, that wonderful phrase, play the man. And what does he say? Something like, we will this day in England light such a torch that now will not be put out. And by the way, if you're fans of Fahrenheit 451 by Ray Bradbury, he actually quotes that in a very interesting way. All right, let us move from courage to temperance. Now, I'm sure everybody here has heard this phrase before. Aristotle said that virtue consists in the golden mean, nothing to excess. Now, what does that mean? Unfortunately, the golden mean is very often misunderstood, especially by Americans. A lot of students think that the golden mean means, well, I'll try anything once. Really? Are you going to try arsenic once? Go ahead, right? That's not what it means, okay? That's a sort of strange way of justifying doing whatever we want. That is not what Aristotle meant. He's very clear in the Nicomachean Ethics what he means. Virtue is the mean between the extremes. Let me explain what this means by going back to courage for a moment. Courage is obviously not cowardice. That's a lack of courage. But courage is also not foolish bravado. Right, rushing in foolishly like a, what's that word, a whirling dervish kind of, you know, crazy man, that is not courage either. That's foolhardy cockiness. Courage is the mean in between those two extremes. It is courage, but a courage that comes together with the wisdom of what you're doing and not some kind of strange death wish. Courage is the mean. In the same way, temperance or self-control is the mean between a sort of over asceticism and a sort of crazy, you know, American fraternity behavior, somewhere in between. Now, like the word charity, temperance is another word that has lost its original richness and fullness of meaning, right? Today, when you say temperance, it means I don't drink, right? Now, that may be part of temperance. It's because we had a movement called the temperance movement. And to prove to you that politics makes strange bedfellows, temperance was put together by the fundamentalists and the feminists. Probably the only time they've ever worked together. Very, very strange movement in our country, right? But that's back when feminists cared about families. So there was a reason to be against alcohol because it destroyed families. Now, don't worry. This is Oxbridge. You're allowed to drink after you leave. Okay, so don't worry. That is not. Temperance is the mean between the two. Maybe the best way to explain temperance, you all remember that song, there is a season, turn, turn, you remember that? Of course, it comes right out of Ecclesiastes. There is a time for sobriety, there is a time for festivity, there is a time for everything under the sun. Temperance is understanding the proper balance. It's understanding when it's a time to laugh and when it's a time to grieve, when it's a time to give up and when it's a time to receive with joy. So often, in America, people have an idea that Jesus is, I'm going to use the negative meaning of this word, some kind of terrible Puritan, some kind of cosmic killjoy. Now, I shouldn't do this because that's not what the original Puritans were like, but you understand the misuse of that word. We have this idea that a negative kind of Puritanism is what Christianity is all about. No. In The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, unfortunately, this scene was left out of the movie, out of the Hollywood movie. There's a wonderful scene where Father Christmas has returned. Right? And Aslan has returned, and the winter is starting to break. Okay? And while the White Witch is going along in her sleigh, the snow is melting, so it kind of gets guts in there, and she has to walk. And as she's walking, she comes upon a group of party animals. Now, when I say party animals, I don't mean fraternity boys from the University of Texas, okay? When I say party animals, I mean literally party animals, right? There's a group of animals that are partying. And when the witch sees them, this is what she says. She says what a lot of people think God or Jesus would say. But it is the witch. It is the devil who says it. What is the meaning of all this revelry, all this waste, all this self-indulgence? Where did you get these things? And the fox says, we got them from Father Christmas. Tell me you're lying. And then she turns them all to stone, right? She again, does not want to see any kind of revelry. There is a time for revelry. Aslan is on the move. He's come back, and there's the right time for this. But a wrong kind of temperance wants to squash all human joy and all human festivity. Again, there is a time for everything under the sun. Even better. Now, one of the most important elements of Prince Caspian is completely lost in the movie, and the reason is because the movie rearranges everything. Now, I understand why, because Prince Caspian has like a 6-chapter flashback that doesn't work well in the Hollywood formula. But I'm sure most of you are familiar with Prince Caspian. There are two dwarves, right? Trumpkin and Nicabrick, right? Now, and again, it's really lost in the movie, but if you read carefully the book, in the beginning of the novel, they're very similar. Neither of the two dwarves believes in Aslan. Neither of the dwarves believes in the four children. They think it's all stuff and moonshine. But Lewis is clever. If you read carefully from the very beginning, there are a series of clues that the two dwarves will eventually go like that. If you know that hideous strength, as you move forward, everything becomes more polarized. The good becomes more good. The bad becomes more bad. That's what happens, right? And eventually, Nicabrick almost calls back the White Witch and dies a traitor. Right? Whereas Trumpkin becomes one of the heroes of Narnia. Now, what are some of the clues? Well, the first clue is that when Prince Caspian lands on their doorstep, Nicabrick wants to kill him, whereas Trumpkin says, we can't kill him, he's a guest. He has an understanding of what the Greeks called hospitality or xenia. But even more important, and again, I'm a Baptist, and you're going to enjoy this, the reason we know from the beginning that Trumpkin will be good and Nicabrick will be bad is that Nicabrick, one, does not smoke, and number two, he does not dance. I'm not making this up. If you go back and read it again, you will see that he's got to be a bad guy because he doesn't understand. Now, the important part is the dancing. Remember, they're there on the lawn, okay, the dancing lawn where the satyrs have danced, and they have their council of war. Well, suddenly the fauns come. They start dancing, and this is why all the Greeks come. We start dancing. It's wonderful stuff, right? But, and it says, everybody danced, even Trumpkin got up and danced, though how did Trumpkin dance? Well, I don't want to make too much fun of engineers today, but how does an engineer dance? This is how an engineer dances. Like the Frankenstein monster, okay? Well, that's kind of how Trumpkin danced, but it doesn't make a difference. He got up and he danced, okay? Whereas Nicabrick refuses to dance, and in refusing to dance, Nicabrick is refusing to join the dance of life. It's a bad or negative kind of asceticism that will lead to him, again, becoming a great villain and traitor. Finally, in temperance, you know, it's really kind of funny. One of the things that Prince Caspian left out completely is one of the most powerful parts of that, and it would have been absolutely cinematic. If you remember, Narnia can only be restored by two things converging. And Eric, the two of us Greek men fighting for the sexes again, masculinity and femininity, can somebody explain to me how this is a triumph for women that now Susan can also kill 100 people? I don't understand how that's any kind of affirmation of femininity, right? In the novel, while the boys, remember that's Edmund and Peter and also Caspian, while they are fighting the duel and fighting the war using their masculine virtues, what are Susan and Lucy doing? They are on the back of Aslan, and they are out there waking up the trees and freeing the countryside. Now, ask any girl who's not been programmed by modern America whether they would rather be fighting on the battlefield or on Aslan's back waking up the trees, and it's not too hard to know which one they would choose, right? Now, remember, to help wake up the trees, they call back Bacchus, the god of wine, women, and so on. What is he doing in a children's novel? I think the movie, even Hollywood, couldn't understand that or accept it. But no, we need Bacchus. We need a kind of fecundity and even a kind of wildness, a revelry, really. Lewis calls them the divine revelers. And you might remember an important line. When they come upon them, Susan says, you know what? If Aslan wasn't here, I'd be afraid of them. And Lucy said, of course I would be too, right? In other words, it's not revelry, but revelry controlled and in the sphere of Aslan, in the proper setting, actually helps to wake up nature, wake up Narnia, wake up the trees, and lead to the defeat of the Telmarines, the bad guys in Prince Caspian. All right, let's move on to the third, wisdom. And I like the word wisdom. It's a Greek word, sophia. Prudence is actually more of a practical kind of wisdom. But wisdom is something, again, that we've lost in the academy, which is really kind of a shame, because you would expect that to be the place where wisdom lives. But we've moved away. And why? All right. Who was the wisest man who ever lived? Solomon, right? The way I read that means he was even wiser than Jesus. I don't know, maybe in his humanity, but Solomon was the wisest man. But what did his wisdom consist in? All right, let me tell you what Solomon wasn't. Solomon was not a rocket scientist. I give this speech often in Houston, and every time I give this speech, there are at least two or three rocket scientists in the crowd, which is kind of strange. But anyway, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with rocket science, but that is not the classical virtue of wisdom. The classical virtue of wisdom is linked to what may be my favorite King James word. Solomon had something that began with the letter D. Does anybody know that word? It's the word discernment. Eric used it today, spiritual discernment, the need. That is what the wisdom of Solomon consisted in. Wisdom is today, wisdom has become specialized knowledge. Now, I'm not against specialized knowledge. If there's something wrong with my eyesight, I want to go to an eye specialist. I'm not against special, but what's happened is, what's killed the university is the specializations in the sciences have invaded the humanities. So you'll get people, they don't just specialize in like the Victorian era, they specialize in one decade of the Victorian era and only know one poet, and that's it, okay? We don't need that many specialists in the humanities, right? But what's happened is it's been invaded, and we've lost the understanding of wisdom as discernment, as a little bit like we used to use the phrase a Renaissance man, a kind of wisdom that understands the full scope of things. Now, a lot of you associate with C.S. Lewis. I get to associate more than most of you because I'm also an English professor like he was. And I will tell you that that means that Lewis has been a role model to me in numerous ways, and one of the ways Lewis has been a role model to me, now I have a specialty, my specialty are the British Romantic and Victorian poets, that was my specialty, Wordsworth particularly, but Lewis showed me the importance of being a generalist, right? Know my specialty, but you need to be, you need to see, and remember what Lewis's specialty was? Medieval and Renaissance literature. Okay, 1,200 years, I mean, that's basically being a generalist, is it not? The only thing Lewis didn't understand was film. I give him a pass, but he just didn't get it, okay? But other than that, he had an amazing grasp of things all the way across the spectrum. He understood that true wisdom means making connections between things. You know when the light bulb goes off in your head? You know what? I've had that light bulb experience so many times, it burned off my hair. I used to have a full head of hair, but the light bulbs just burned everything away. It's very, very strange. Now, wisdom is that which discerns. Solomon asked for wisdom, okay, not special. He didn't ask to be a political science major, okay? As a friend of mine once said, I can't remember where I heard this, but the Titanic was built by experts. Noah was a generalist, okay? I thought that was good. So, you know, he was an amateur, so think about that. I just lost my train of thought. So discernment means having, Solomon asked for wisdom because the reason he asked for wisdom was, I am a young man, I lack experience, how will I rule these people unless I can discern between good and evil, black and white, right and wrong, virtue and vice? I need that or I cannot rule these people. Another thing that has changed, wisdom. Until yesterday, wisdom was linked with older people and the wisdom of experience. Today, it's more and more linked to hotshot young people. Right? Again, we need young and old wisdom, but we've lost the understanding of wisdom as having a broad perspective. Now, if you lose your wisdom, you are a fool. And the Bible does not shy away from using the word fool, especially in Proverbs. But when it says fool, it doesn't just mean an intellectual fool, it means a moral fool. It means someone that lacks discernment in all areas. And Lewis, in the Narnia Chronicles, gives us a perfect example of what happens when we lose all of our discernment. In the last battle, the only children's novel ever written where the book ends with all the kids dead. This is amazing. I just love it. Yeah. Except poor Susan. We won't go there. But very, very strange. I'm sure most of you are familiar with that story. What happens is we get to a point where there is this stable. And basically, when you go through the stable door, you are dead. And the good characters, when they go through the stable door, they find themselves ultimately in heaven. They're about to go into Aslan's country. They're in a restored Garden of Eden with wonderful trees and fruit, all this wonderful stuff. But the dwarves, who have become evil, who have lost their wisdom, who have lost their fear of the Lord, because the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, it is the beginning of discernment, when they're thrown into the stable, they don't see the light, they don't see the trees, they don't see the fruit. They see themselves locked up in a pokey, smelly little stable, and they're there in pitch blackness. And Lucy, always the kind one, says, "No, look around you, it's beautiful, look." And she takes some flowers and puts them in their nose. "Ah, don't put that on my nose, that's nasty, oh my God." Doesn't work, right? They try to give them a touch, a smell, a taste. They're all messed up. They cannot discern where they are. They're caught in darkness. Well, finally, Aslan appears. And Lucy says, "Aslan, isn't there something you can do for these poor dwarves?" And Aslan says, amazingly, "Dearest, I will tell you exactly what I can and what I cannot do." And he roars, and a wonderful feast is laid out in front of them. Right? And wine, the kids are always drinking wine in the Narnia Chronicles. We just won't think about that, okay? But anyway, it's all laid out. Luckily, there's no strong liquor as far as I can tell, but it's laid out in front of them. But guess what? They can't taste it. When they start eating it, it tastes like, you know, nasty stable hay and putrid water. And they're throwing it all over the place, right? And Aslan explains. He says, "They have chosen cunning instead of belief. Their prison is only in their mind, but it is a real prison. And they are so afraid of being taken in that they cannot be taken out." Today, we tend to think wisdom means empiricism, right? Empiricism is the idea that all we can know is what comes through our five senses. But our five senses are not enough. If we lose wisdom, if we lose discernment, right? We are not going to, our five senses, we can't trust them. They're all going to be out of whack, right? We also seem to think today that wisdom means cynicism. That's one of the things that absolutely kills academia. You go in, you know, you're an English professor, like, you know, you go to get a bachelor's in English, and then you want to get a PhD in English, and you think, "Wow, I'm going to get a PhD in literature. Everybody there is going to love literature the way I do." Most of them are cynical. Most of them are skeptical. Most of them don't learn anything from the wisdom that they read, right? We've cut ourselves off. Wisdom, okay? It starts with the fear of the Lord, and it leads to a kind of discernment that is 100,000 miles away from skepticism and cynicism. Right? Finally, the fourth and final of the classical virtues is justice. And of all the virtues, this may be the hardest one for our modern American society to understand. Because, folks, justice is not the same thing as fairness. Let me challenge you right now. Fairness is a concern of adolescent children who insist that everybody has exactly the same piece of pie. Justice is giving to each person what is their due, and that will often be different. Now, we are equal before the law. We are equal in dignity and inherent worth before God. But justice, I'm sorry, understood for the last 3,000 years, goes together with an understanding of hierarchy. That's a hard word in America. In fact, most of you, have you ever read the Constitution? In our Constitution, nobody's allowed to be like a baron or a duke. It's actually almost funny when you read it today, how insistent they were. Now, in a certain extent, I think they made the right decision. But we have pulled ourselves away so we can no longer see beauty in difference. We can no longer see beauty in hierarchy. And folks, I would argue that our culture, America, now I think we're all Americans here, the few British people sneaking in here with that little accent, you know, but I think we're mostly Americans here, right? Maybe a few Australians sneaked in. But in America, we have got to understand again justice and hierarchy. And I will prove to you that we are hungry for it, even if we don't know we are. Has anybody ever been to the Renaissance Festival? Do you have one near where you live? We have a huge one in Houston, okay? I love going to the Renaissance Festival and looking around at me, because 90% of the people at the Renaissance Festival are people with whom I have nothing whatsoever in common, okay? These are mostly people that are super far to the left, super liberal, want nothing to, you know, And yet, they realize that there is a kind of beauty. Why? One of the reasons I think Lord of the Rings has been so popular is its understanding of kingship and hierarchy and how that brings meaning to us. Folks, Jesus was not an egalitarian. Now let me explain that word. Egalitarian is not the same thing as equal. We are equal before the law. We're equal. Egalitarian is this idea we should all be treated the same. And people say, of course Jesus was an egalitarian. Look at the foot washing. Right? Actually read the foot washing in John. It begins by saying, and Jesus, knowing that all authority had been given to him, knelt down and washed the disciples' feet. So first of all, it comes from a position of strength. But then, and people often miss this, if Jesus wanted to change everything, right after he washed their feet, he would say, see, disciples, there are no such thing as distinctions anymore. We're all the same. Deal with it. That's not what he says. He says, you call me master and Lord, and you are right to do so. The student is not greater than the teacher. The messenger is not greater than the master who sent him. But I am teaching you a new kind of stewardship, a kind of servant leadership. So Jesus did change so that the leader is a steward. But he didn't throw out all distinctions between people, right? In fact, one of his favorite phrases in the Gospels is, the student is not greater than the teacher, the servant is not greater than me. He says it again and again. He's not throwing out distinctions. He is calling on those who are in any kind of leadership position. As a professor, I have power over my students. That means I need to use it properly and use it to help the students develop and grow, not to smack them over the head with a bully pulpit. It was that crazy Ross Perot used to use that word. I still don't know what it means, but anyway, bully pulpit. So justice, okay? Justice accepts and understands distinctions. Remember the magician's nephew? Diggory, by some, you know, bad choices, has caused the White Witch, who will become the White Witch, Queen Jadis, to come into Narnia. And Aslan says, before my world is a few hours old, evil has already entered into it. But I'm going to do something to stem that evil. I'm going to do two things. The first thing he does is sends Diggory on a quest to get a magic apple to build a tree of protection. But that's only one of two things. The other thing he does is takes Frank, a cab driver, in the days when what you drove was a horse, Frank and his wife, Nellie, and he makes them the first king and queen of Narnia. He establishes a kingship in order to help protect Narnia from the growing evil of the White Witch. And remember that important line in Prince Caspian. In Prince Caspian, remember the evil Telmarines have taken over, but the good Prince Caspian is like the old kings, right? And we have that meeting there, and they're trying to decide what to do. And Nicabric gets really upset. There's a character named Truffle Hunter, right? Who's a badger. And Truffle Hunter is all excited about the return of the king. And Nicabric says, what are you excited? Narnia is not a place for humans. It's a place for animals. And what does the badger say? Truffle Hunter says, yes, Narnia is a place for animals, but it's a place for a man to be king of. He says, Lord, as long as you will be good king, I will swear my allegiance to you. The badger does not feel oppressed by having a human king over him. He understands the proper hierarchy, and it puts him in an understanding of who he is and what he is and what his role is in Narnia. Okay, so justice is something we need to understand again in America. All right, let's look at the theological virtues now. Faith, hope, and love. What is faith? Now, it's lucky that the Bible actually gives us a definition. The Bible's not a textbook. It's not into definitions, except a few things. But it actually gives us an actual definition of faith. Faith is the evidence of things not seen, the assurance of things hoped for, right? Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, right? Faith is a new kind of seeing, a radically new kind of seeing that can see past the present difficulty to the joy that is on the other side. Faith, as I like to say, sees the kairos. Some of you know that in Greek, there are two different words for time. There is chronos, like chronology, just means regular chronological time. And there is kairos, or kairos, which means time in the sense of an opportune moment, the critical time, the time when everything comes together. Faith looks forward to the kairos. Right? the Beatitudes. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. If you're going to understand the Beatitudes, you have to have the faith that looks through the mourning to see the comfort that comes on the other side, right? I don't know if you've ever read this carefully, but in the Gospel of John, there's a lot of use of what's called parallelism. You know how that works in the Psalms? Blessed is the Lord, glory to the Holy One, where you say the same thing. Well, remember the famous John chapter 3, Nicodemus? Jesus says to him, right, unless you're born again, you cannot enter the kingdom. Then he says again, unless you're born of water and the Spirit, you cannot see the kingdom. He actually equates seeing the kingdom with entering the kingdom, right? We have to have eyes to see. Now, in Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, you have to have faith to see how all of the prophecies are coming together. On the one hand, there is wrong will be right when Aslan comes in sight. On the other hand, there is when Adam's flesh and Adam's bone sits at Kerparavel's throne. There is a prophecy about Aslan, the return, and there's a prophecy about the four children. And when the two come together, Mr. Beaver, who has the eyes of faith, sees that the kairos is upon us, that the moment that everything's been waiting for, it's coming to a head. If I may paraphrase my favorite Christmas carol, the hopes and fears of all the years are met in Narnia tonight. Right? But if you don't have eyes of faith to see it, you will not see. You know that wonderful super long chapter of Lord of the Rings? It's called The Council of Elrond. Right? There's like 10,000 prophecies all coming together in an endlessly long chapter, right? But it's a wonderful thing. Anybody that really loves Tolkien loves that chapter, despite all of the details, because we get to see how everything's connected and how the fate is being worked out, right? That's why in Prince Caspian, Dr. Cornelius has the eyes of faith. He is looking for any traces of the remnant of the dwarves and the talking animals. He has eyes of faith. But you know who lacks the eyes of faith? In the last battle, Tyrion in the beginning, Tyrion becomes a hero, but the last king of Narnia in the beginning of that book lacks the eyes of faith. Rune with the centaur says, "Sire, Aslan is not coming back. It is not true. I've never seen worse, you know, connections of the stars in 1,000 years. But in the beginning, the rash young Tyrion lacks the eyes of faith, and he doesn't realize, and he foolishly thinks that the phony Aslan is a real Aslan. I'm sorry, I'm hoping you know the stories so I can move more quickly here. All right, let's move on to hope. Of the three theological virtues, hope is the one that is least understood and actually is the most under attack in the Western world. Because in the modern world, hope, people with hope are often accused of looking for pie in the sky by and by. The people out there in the world, whether from the right or the left, who think they are going to build utopia on this earth, do not like the theological virtue of hope, right? Because those who have the eyes of hope know that, I mean, we do the best we can to alleviate things in this world. We are Christians, but we know that it will not be perfect until the kingdom of God comes. And our eyes of hope allow us, kind of like faith, but hope is something more that rests on the promises of Christ and of the Bible. Hope is linked to what the great Catholic theologians of the Middle Ages called felix culpa, one of my favorite phrases of theology. Felix is the Latin word for happy, as in felicity, and culpa is like mea culpa. It's the word for guilt or fall or flaw. Felix culpa means happy flaw. Now, what is that a reference to? The happy flaw, or happy guilt, or happy fault, is a reference to the fall of man. Now, are these theologians crazy? The fall of man is the worst thing that ever happened, and yet they call it a happy fall? It's a happy fall because if you have the eyes of hope, then you will see that that fall led to a greater outpouring of love that we call the incarnation when God became man. We got 5 minutes? What do I have, 5 minutes? Five, okay, I'll finish up. I will make it. I lost my train of thought again, sorry. What is the phrase that we use when we refer to the day that Jesus was crucified? We call it Good Friday. Have we lost our minds? Good Friday? But with the eyes of hope, the eyes that understand felix culpa, the Good Friday is good because it leads to the great triumph of Easter Sunday. Right? So, Now, I still don't understand this because Tolkien, of course, was a very committed Catholic. And he wanted to describe Felix Culpa, and he said, you know what, there's no word for this, so I'm going to invent one. Well, there actually is a word for it, but I'm still glad that Tolkien overlooked that because he gave us a beautiful word, the eucatastrophe. You recognize that word? EU is the Greek word that means good, like eugenics, right? Euphonious. Eucatastrophe is the good catastrophe. It means the same thing as Felix Culpa, but he seemed to forget that. I don't know. But the eucatastrophe of the fall is the incarnation. The eucatastrophe of the crucifixion is the resurrection. And what do we get in The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe? Notice how cleverly the character of Edmund combines Adam and Judas. Edmund is like Adam, who, you know, the Turkish delight is kind of linked to the eating of the apple. But remember, he betrays his siblings when they're at dinner at the house of the beavers. And so that makes him like Judas. And it's important because both of the falls, the fall of man and the crucifixion, are linked together. But through dying, Aslan resurrects to new life. Now, I grew up and came to know Christ in the Greek Orthodox Church. And fellow Greeks here. And my favorite part of the Greek church is the hymn that is sung at Easter, Christos Anesti, or Christ is risen. And these are the words in English. Christ is risen from the dead by death trampling upon death. In Greek, the way it looks in Greek, word by word, is by death, death trampling. So you have the two words for death right next to each other with different endings. Can't do that in English, but you can do it in Greek or Latin. So by death, death was trampled. And that's exactly what happens in Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. But only those with eyes. So finally, let's end with love. Almost out of time here. Let me end with the understanding of love. Love is that which pities and forgives. But please understand that when we say pity, we don't mean manipulative pity. If you've read The Great Divorce or The Screwtape Letters or know anything about Mrs. Moore, you will understand that manipulative pity is one of the great terrible things that the devil uses. But true pity, true love, is the movement out of yourself towards the other person, right? That is what it does. And that kind of love is redemptive. My favorite definition of love is the movement out of narcissism. Love moves out of itself towards the other. Remember that Lewis phrase that Gilbert Mylander used? Love has a taste for the other. Remember that was a famous book by Gilbert Mylander about Lewis, A Taste for the Other. And let me end here with, again, there's obviously lots of examples of love in Narnia, but my favorite, the moment in Narnia that always brings tears to my eyes is in The Magician's Nephew, which is actually my favorite of the Seven Chronicles. In The Magician's Nephew, again, if you know that, Diggory is, I love it because it's really autobiographical. Diggory, like the young Lewis, has a mother back home in London who is dying of cancer. And he comes into the new world, sees how fecund it is, the fecundity growing. And he thinks, if I go to Aslan, maybe he can give me something that will help my mother. Right? And he goes up to Aslan. Please, sir, is there anything you can do for my mother? And Lewis says, up until now, Diggory had been looking at the lion's paws. Now, with a little bit of courage, he looked up at his face. And what he saw there amazed him. For wonder of wonders, in the eyes of the lion were tears. Huge tears. So huge that Diggory thought for a moment that Aslan must be more sorry for his mother than he was. And Aslan looks at the boy and says, I know. I know. Grief is great. Only you and I know that in this new world. Let us be good to one another. Now, if you know The Magician's Nephew, you will know that Diggory goes on a quest to get that apple I mentioned a moment ago. Now, I think that this may be the most difficult temptation that I've ever read in any novel, much less a children's novel. There's a moment where the white witch says to Diggory, if you won't take the apple for yourself, take it, bring it back home, and use it to heal your mother. Now, this is a terrible temptation for a 9-year-old boy. What am I going to do? But he doesn't do it. But here's the part I want to end with. He decides not to do it. Takes the apple and they fly back on Fledge's back. They fly back to Aslan. And while they're flying back, Lewis says this. There were many times on the journey back when Diggory wasn't fully sure that he'd made the right decision. But whenever he remembered
the tears in Aslan's eyes, he knew that he was right. Father God, we pray that you would help reinstill the seven virtues in our country. Lord, begin by instilling them in us and let us share them with others. Not, as Eric said, not casting our pearls before swine, but sharing the love of Christ, moving out of ourselves, making virtue exciting again, making it desirable and lovely. Costly, yes, but lovely and desirable nonetheless. Lord, we thank you for the legacy of C.S. Lewis, that he gave us children's stories that embody these virtues so we can understand them not only with our mind, but with our heart as well. In Jesus' name, amen.